It's time for security now. Steve Gibson's here. Once again, we talk about the Internet of Things and how to secure your home from all these little doohickeys that are online. Turns out Steve's got the best way to do it. We mentioned guest networks before. We mentioned a two-router solution, but the real robust way to do it, three dumb routers. Stay tuned. Security Now is next.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Security Now is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is Security Now with Steve Gibson, episode 545, recorded Tuesday, February 2nd, 2016. Three dumb routers. Security Now is brought to you by IT Pro TV. Upgrade your brain for 2016. IT Pro TV is the resource to keep your IT skills up to date with engaging and informative video tutorials. For a free 7-day trial and 30% off the lifetime of your account, go to itpro.tv/securitynow and use the code SN30. And by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting software that's giving thousands of freelancers and small businesses the tools to save time billing and get paid faster. Try it free at freshbooks.com/securitynow. It's time for Security Now, the show that in this case is very aptly named. Two dumb routers plus a third, just you. No. Steve Gibson is here. We are going to talk about routers in just a little bit. He is the guy at GRC.com, the creator of SpinRight, the man who does the best job ever of explaining not just security, but technology in general. And now 10 years in, people are loving this show, I know. And I hear from people all the time. Who did I just get an email from? Oh, I know what it was. I just read a post, my favorite podcasts. And the fellow who wrote the post was on Medium. What did he write? I got to find the quote because he wrote a very nice thing about Security Now and wow, how geeky the show is.
Oh, and believe me, we will not disappoint him this week.
So, Steve-O, hello. What's
yo,
on this
my friend.
Slate?
So, we did not have a lot of news, which is just as well. That and the Iowa caucus. I knew I wasn't going to get, you know, because I'm a complete political junkie. And so yesterday was, you know, there was no way I could be, you know, producing a 20-page podcast of notes beforehand.
Wait a minute. What were you doing? I mean, what were you watching? You were watching Iowans gather and
I was watching slow counts of delegates.
Very slow.
To see whether Bernie was going to actually get ahead of Hillary or whether she was going to,
seriously, if you take Iowa seriously. Did you see our podcast, our triangulation yesterday?
No.
Oh, you should see it. The guy was the, for 4 years, advisor to then Secretary of State Clinton on innovation and technology. And he's a Silicon Valley guy. And I asked him to give us kind of an inside the beltway view of what it looks like to Washington wonks when the real world, you know, and so forth. It was really a very interesting stuff. But he, you know, we both concurred. Iowa is the craziest way is to start this campaign season. It all comes down to Super Tuesday. There's so many delegates then. And until then, it's not really that important.
No, and in fact, for me as a junkie, it's funny too because I was thinking about your comment about my enthusiasm for various TV series that I watch. And last week you said, "Wow, you know, you watch a lot of television." And I thought, "Yeah, you know, Leo, how many hours of sports do you have on your television? Because I have zero.
I don't watch that much sports. I watch maybe I watch an NFL game for 16 weeks a year, once a week. No, I'm not a big sports fanatic, but I do. Okay. I'm not critical because I watch a lot of TV too. Lately, I've been playing more Minecraft, but that's another story. For another day.
You haven't really? Because I know that a long time you haven't like understood what that was all about. And I've watched the last few weeks beginning to sort of like understand the whole Minecraft phenomenon.
Lisa's son, Michael, who's 13, has been a Minecraft buff for like 5 years since it really came out. And is quite adept at it. Really adept at it. And he's been begging me to create a Minecraft server in our house. Actually, it ties in very well to the subject of the show today because I always said to him, oh, no, no, it's too dangerous to run our own server. You can rent Minecraft servers or public servers. Just use those. But finally, I got a Raspberry Pi, and I was trying to think, what could I do with this Raspberry Pi? And I thought, you know, this actually would be, it's just a little Linux, $35 Linux computer. This would be a great Minecraft server. So I set it up. And it was so easy that I said, gosh, but it did, but you can only get five people in at a time because it's not very powerful. In fact, it kind of lags.
And so is that the reason for having a server, is that he would then be able to host
his own clubhouse? Group? Yeah. Servers, the nice thing about Minecraft is the work you do is persistent. So it creates a world, which is then the world, and it's infinite. It's huge. It's not completely infinite, but I think it's limited to 30 terabytes of data. So it's functionally infinite, and it's persistent. So if you build a house and come back tomorrow, the house is still there. So he and his friends come in. It's like their clubhouse. And now with kids today, they don't really get to go play, right? Go out in the street and play. You can't do that anymore. You
might skin your knee.
Yeah. So, and he's kind of inclined to sit in front of the computer anyway. So I thought this would be great, and it might be a way for us to bond a little bit. So we set up the server. Then I realized I need a more powerful computer, and I had that Mac Pro in the corner. So it's running on a very powerful computer now.
Yeah.
In fact, so much so that I've put two more servers because I thought, well, that was easy. Maybe I wonder if I could find the old Twit Minecraft server, and it turned out.
So is there a Minecraft server for Mac? Is that like that?
And
exists?
I'm running a third. Well, there's many. There's the official.
And what was Minecraft written in? Was
Java. It written? That's why Java.
That's what I thought. Yeah.
So it runs everywhere.
I remember there was something about it. Yeah. It
runs everywhere, and the server because it's not a GUI. Is really easy to be portable, right? So it's Linux, Windows, OS 10, whatever.
Well, we will, in this podcast, it's as you said, it's perfect because I will explain to you why if the Minecraft server was known by bad guys to have a flaw, that would allow them to completely get into and take over your home network.
See, that's my concern because, of course, I'm using port forwarding. I don't DMZ the computer.
Doesn't help you.
It's one single port, UDP, TCP.
Doesn't help you.
They go in. But you're right. If there's a flaw in the server, and by the way, there probably is.
How could there not be? Yeah. Look at the stuff we talk about, like OpenSSL.
And this is just some kids wrote it, right? I'm using a third-party server.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, good. I would, behooves one to keep it up to date, but B, I'd like to know how to make it a little bit safer.
Okay, so today's podcast is titled Three Dumb Routers. And not three blind mice, three dumb routers. First, I titled it Router Topology. I thought, well, that's just sort of dry and boring. So, and Three Dumb Routers is actually a much better title because what I'm going to explain, and this is going to be a deep in the weeds, we're going to be talking about ARP broadcasts and IP to MAC address resolution. I want to explain why no two router solution can work. Last week, I suggested that the IoT devices be put on what I would call the interior router, the router inside your main router. And I got a whole bunch of people saying, oh, Gibson, you got that backwards. Well, yeah, I understand that. 10 years ago, and Leo, in fact, if you go to there is a link to it at the very end of the show notes, but also just in the GRC menu, it's under Research General NAT Router Security, I think I called it. 10 years ago, in 2006, in August, I first presented this idea of daisy chaining routers, chaining them together. And I drew a picture of a router as sort of like a one-way valve where stuff could go out, but it couldn't come back in. And on those pages, I did put the high security network on the inside. The problem is that's not secure either. So my point is that no two router solution. Yep, there's the picture. So I sort of showed it as a valve with a flap where stuff could go out, but it couldn't come in. And if you scroll down about halfway, you'll see a diagram with two routers further down, where they're a little more down, further up. There it is. So there's the super secure LAN on the internal NAT, and the semi-secure LAN on the sort of in between the two. And the problem is that's got problems. So it really doesn't matter which way you put them. And I was trying to compromise, and I shouldn't have. So this week is the zero compromise. This is the way you do it. If you have dumb routers, and you just want absolute security, absolute network isolation between an Internet of Things network and your regular home network. There are all kinds of ways to do this with fancy routers, with like, you know, pfSense and firewalls and rules and so forth. You really probably want to use VLANs, virtual local area networks, in order to get true what's called broadcast domain isolation. Anyway, I'm going to explain all about that at the end of this podcast. That's the topic. And we didn't really have much news.
Second week in a row, those hackers are getting, they're slackers.
Has been quiet. One thing I got a kick out of, speaking of Java, is that in a sort of, we're not the first people to give up on browser plugins, the so-called Java platform group at Oracle formally announced the end of the browser Java plugin. It's like, you know, and I mean, if anything, this podcast could be called, why has this taken so long? Because, you know, for years, you know, 10 years ago, Leo, for years, starting at the beginning of the podcast, it was email viruses. It was, it's like, okay, Microsoft, turn off scripting in email. Turn it off. And it just took forever. And similar, it was like, Microsoft, turn on the XP firewall by default. Well, that took them until Service Pack 2 to get around to doing that. So this is, you know, Oracle, kill the Java plugin. And yes,
there's only one left now, and it's Flash. And you kill that, and then we're done, right? Everything's going to be secure. Everybody's going to be happy.
Exactly. I got a kick out of this blog post because this was like, okay, so here's what they said. By late 2015, so right, you know, a couple months ago, many browser vendors have either removed or announced timelines for the removal of standards-based plugin support. Eliminating, this is Oracle speaking, eliminating the ability to embed Flash, Silverlight, Java, and other plugin-based technologies. So, of course, it's not that it was always a horrible idea. It's that, well, you know, everybody else is, you know, saying they're not going to support this anymore. So, continuing, Oracle says, with modern browser vendors working to restrict and reduce plugin support in their products, developers of applications that rely on the Java browser plugin need to consider alternative options, such as migrating from Java applets, which rely on a browser plugin, to the plugin-free Java Web Start technology. Oracle plans to deprecate the Java browser plugin in JDK, that's the Java Development Kit 9. This technology will be removed from the Oracle JDK and JRE, that's the Java Runtime Engine, in a future Java SE release. And then they give some links about, you know, JDK 9, talking about how it's coming. So, yes, this got picked up by the tech press and saying, yes, finally, Java is being removed from the browsers. And mostly what Java is saying is, well, you know, We didn't want to give up, but the browsers are refusing to host our plugin anymore in one form or another. So we're not going to fight it. We're killing it off completely. And then, so what they'll have is they'll have this Java Web Start technology. I've not taken a look at yet, but it's not a plugin in the browser. And let's just hope it doesn't have its own set of catastrophic problems. It sounds frightening. I mean, the only thing that that might save it is if it requires, you know, a lot of user interaction and verification before it runs something that you obtain from just promiscuous web surfing, which is never safe when Java is your target. I mean, Java's a full strength programming language, as you were just saying. You know, Minecraft was written in it. It's, you can do anything with it that you need to, which is also part of its benefit. The problem is you don't want to stick it in a web page for all the reasons we've been talking about for the last decade. Also,
is NPAPI the plugin that they're referring to? That's the deprecated plugin from Firefox. It must be the NPAPI.
NPAPI is Netscape's own browser API.
Right.
So, but there's Java plugins for all browsers historically. Okay, so yesterday Google gave us their Nexus security bulletin for Android. And these are fixes for February. Short version is you want to, if you have a Google Nexus device, you absolutely want to update, because these are not really bone chilling, but they're a concern. And it's funny, as I was looking through this and pulling this together for the show, I thought, okay, this sounds exactly like a set of security notices for a, like, that we've been covering for years for, like, you know, a Mac or a PC. And it's like, oh yes, Android is a full-blown operating system. Even though it's hiding in a smartphone, typically, it's, you know, it's as much of a connected OS as any of the ones we've been discussing. So it's good to see that, you know, movement in the direction of this consumer device, which is as much an OS as the desktop devices, being given the same kind of attention for security. There were two critical vulnerabilities found and fixed by this update yesterday, found in Broadcom's Wi-Fi driver, which is part of Google's Nexus build for Android. And the concern is that anyone who leverages this vulnerability can potentially execute code remotely, but only if they're on the same Wi-Fi. This is why I said this wasn't as bone-chilling as some that we've seen before. So there are two remote code execution vulnerabilities, but they involve the way the Broadcom Wi-Fi kernel driver deals with wireless control message packets. So it's a subtle problem, only affects Wi-Fi LAN. That is, it is not exploitable at a great distance. So it would be somebody on the same Wi-Fi network as you. The problem is that if this doesn't get patched, if it can be turned into a remote code execution vulnerability, no one is saying yet that that's been done. All they're saying is that they're able to corrupt kernel memory, which typically means that externally provided data can be forced into the system. And once the bad guys figure out how to execute that externally provided data, that gives them a remote code execution opportunity. So that you want to fix. Media server, this very troubled module, which of course gave us stage fright and lots of coverage last year, is continuing to deliver. We got two critical security vulnerabilities that additional ones have just been found and fixed in it. And those are also, those, unlike this Broadcom Wi-Fi problem, are remotely exploitable. Again, this is somebody sends you something from anywhere and that can cause problems. So, web browsing, email, MMS files, just basically your device needs to process a maliciously crafted media file. Anything that some bad guy can do to get that to happen can potentially compromise your security. So, and then there were some moderate and there were four high severity and one moderate. But anyway, as I said, as I was going through this, it's like, wow, this sounds just like a regular OS getting its security fixed. And in fact, that's what it is. Our friend Mary Jo Foley noted in her ZDNet column and the Hacker News and Beta News and everybody picked up on the fact that Windows 10 upgrade has, as promised, moved Windows 10 upgrading from optional to recommended in the Windows Update event. So I imagine, here we are on February 2nd, the first Tuesday of the month. On the 9th, next week, which will be Patch Tuesday for Microsoft, we may find that there is now a recommended update for people who haven't yet from Microsoft. So if you haven't yet, if you don't want Windows 10 for whatever reason, you won't want to wait more than a week before doing what you can. And we've talked about that often, the various, like the GWX control panel is the slam dunk easy thing to do to block Windows 10. And there are, and as we covered last week or the week before, Microsoft has now actually got an update that adds features to Windows 7 and 8.1 to allow you to using Microsoft sanctioned approach to prevent the Windows 10 update on a system where you don't want that to happen. I got two tweets that I thought were interesting. I just wanted to share on this whole ongoing and very interesting dialogue about where we stand with encryption. Matt tweeted me yesterday morning. He said at SGGRC, "You keep talking about Apple being able to do safe warrant access crypto. What about all the others that can't but would have to?" And I thought, wow, that is a good point. It's not something that I even thought of. And so I wanted to thank Matt for bringing that up, and I wanted to share it because, I think it's a good point. I've talked about, Apple's billions of dollars and their budget and their clearly proven ability to create the equivalent of a very high security safe where individual unlock keys for every single one of their phones would be kept under, this hypothetical solution that I've proposed as sort of a compromise, which would not be a backdoor, but would be a way of allowing Apple under court order to provide a key. And then, of course, last week we also talked about the idea of it also requiring physical access. But what I hadn't considered, and the Matt brought up, is that, well, okay, but what about all the other companies? I mean, if this was the way things worked, suddenly everybody would have big safes of users' keys. And that's clearly a deal killer. I barely trust Apple, and all of our experience is that in general, companies can't keep secrets. It's incredibly difficult to do. As a result, people are, having all their personal details published and passwords lost, and everyone's having to run around and change their passwords all the time. So anyway, I'm really glad that Matt brought that up because it wasn't on my radar. And it's like, whoa, that's a very good point. And this came in a DM, and I didn't have the guy's permission to share it, so I won't share his name. But he said the U.S. might have laws preventing unreasonable search, but a lot of countries in which Apple does business have no such protections. If you make the phone technically accessible to U.S. authorities, you make it technically accessible to every country's authorities. And that's not necessarily the case. So I wanted to rebut that a little bit and use that opportunity to clarify that, you know, that this sort of compromise I've been talking about would require that the vendor of a technology like a smartphone keep a safe of individual keys. Now, it's true if, for example, a foreign government required those keys to be stored in their country, then that might limit that the vendor's control and security management of those keys, and once again, we're in trouble. So maybe there's no way to do this. I think this has been, if nothing else, a useful thought experiment, because it's the only compromise I can come up with. But, you know, holes are getting punched in it that are good holes. So I wanted to share those. We talked last week about Netstat as a useful, ubiquitously available since the beginning of Unix, well, the beginning of the internet on Unix, which is where the internet was born, command line tool. And a number of people tweeted and reminded me that our friend Mark Rusinovich has TCP view. It is a Windows-only solution. So one of the reasons I wanted to talk about Netstat is it is available for the Mac and Linux machines. I mean, if you have a TCP/IP stack in your machine, along with it will be commands like ping and traceroute and Netstat. But I did want to mention TCP view because there are so many Windows systems, and it is free. It's a cute little, I think it's 285K download. Nicely written, like Mark stuff. Doesn't require registration. It's just an exe that you run. The first time you run it, you agree to a license, and I think you must make a mark in the registry or something, because it doesn't ask you every time, but you don't have to even install it. It's an exe that you run, very much like mine. And it does provide a very nice dynamically updating GUI display as opposed to a command prompt. So I would say that's way more practical for most users who are using Windows. And there's likely utilities for the other OSs that are similar. I've been talking a little bit about sleep. And Leo, you know that I've been, you know, focusing on sleep and insomnia, and I mentioned last week that I was working on refining a solution which was going to work for me to keep me asleep all night. The particular type of insomnia I have is where I'm able to go to sleep very quickly, but after about 4 hours, like around maybe 3 a.m. or 4 a.m., my eyes open, right, and I'm like wide awake. And then, you know, in the past have laid there for a couple hours trying to go back to sleep, sometimes succeeding, sometimes not. When my friends at Starbucks see me, it's on mornings when I just gave up and I went in and was at Starbucks when they opened. I also mentioned previously that when I decided I was going to tackle this, I back in the, like around the early, I guess toward the middle of October, I purchased a couple so-called sleep monitors. And these are things like when was the Jawbone U3, and I also got the top of the line Fitbit, and did some research. They looked like the best things available, and sadly, they're very limited. You know, they're so-called actigraphs, or they use actigraphy, which is to say they monitor how active you are.
It's a fancy word for, did he move his arm?
Yeah, exactly. You know, and you know, they have, you know, they can measure body temperature, heart rate, maybe respiration. You get respiration, interestingly enough, because whenever we exhale, our heart rate slows down just a little bit. And when we inhale, our heart rate increases. And so by doing beat-to-beat, interbeat interval measuring, a device which is monitoring your heart rate can also determine your rate of respiration. So there's a lot they can get. But as I had mentioned before on this podcast, unless you are hooked up to someone's head, you just don't know what's going on inside. There is no way. And as you just mentioned, you know, if you lay really still and aren't flopping around in bed, it thinks you're asleep. So I purchased, tried, and returned both of those.
Oh.
Because they were just junk. I would compare what they said to what I knew had happened, and there was no correlation. I mean, yes, am I disco dancing or am I in bed? That it could determine. But had no idea otherwise. So as you know, because I shared this with you a couple of months ago.
Top secrecy,
because I knew the moment I mentioned this, they would disappear. And I wanted my closest friends to have access to this technology. And then in successive spheres, I would make it more available. There was a company founded in 2003 called Zio. It was originally named Axon, cool name, Axon Labs, founded by four Brown University students at the very end of 2003. And their goal was to create a true, practical, real EEG sleep monitor. They ran for 10 years. And during the course of those 10 years, from 2003 to 2013, they produced three products. The first was a bedside clock radio format where it had a display, and it was an electroluminescent display, and you put this headband on, which went around your head, sitting on your forehead, and it had a little pod on it, about 2 inches by 1 inch. And the headband snapped onto the pod, and on the inside were in three in a row, three silver cloth sort of, well, they're electrodes, which were able to measure your EEG, your brain waves, from the front of your forehead. And also, due to their position, they were able to pick up what's known as muscle artifact, which is the electrical signals caused by your eye muscles. And, of course, that's useful because rapid eye movement, REM sleep, is one of the acknowledged stages of sleep. So by being positioned above your eyes on your forehead, they could actually get your brain waves and pick up your eye movement muscle artifact. The problem was, so that product was developed and existed, and it could dump out onto an SD card, and then you were able to use the SD card to transfer it to other things. This was sort of, 2003? Where was the internet in 2003? I'm not completely clear on that.
It was on my server, no.
Was it beginning to happen?
It was happening big time. Remember, had the bust by 2000.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Okay. So...
It was a long time ago, wasn't it?
It was. I'm talking like, wow.
12 years ago. Yeah.
What did we have then? Then they did a less expensive version that had a docking station that you docked this pod in. And then finally, their very last one. And I actually...
Steve's reaching over to get it.
Reaching is this thing, which was called the Zio Sleep Manager Pro. And they reduced it down to just the pod with the headband and a smartphone. because, you know, later in the company life, they could assume that everybody had smartphones. The original device was not dependent upon a smartphone. Okay, so it turns out this is the real deal. And, I mean, it works unbelievably well. If you go to grc.com/Zio, you will find a web page I just put up this morning. What happened is a surplus reseller on eBay purchased a bunch of stock of these final Zio units, the pods, the headbands, their charging cord, and so forth, and have been selling them. The problem was they didn't have enough. I wrote to them and said, okay, you know, I know that there are people who listen to my podcast who are going to be, you know, think the idea of actually monitoring their sleep is cool. But, you know, 10 isn't going to do it. So how many do you have? And they responded that they have many hundreds, maybe 1,000. So I've been waiting until they relisted them, which happened on Saturday. So I tweeted the news. First, I let everyone in GRC's health news group know so that they could get them. Then I tweeted the news on Sunday so that my Twitter followers would know. And now I'm telling everybody on the podcast, which is essentially the entire universe. So what's cool is that they are selling these brand new, never used, sealed, not in the final packaging because the packaging doesn't exist. This was just these were purchased from, you know, probably out of bankruptcy or after the company closed as it was liquidating its assets. But for $40 on eBay right now, these little Zio pods are available. You must have an Android device because Google Play Store still has the Zio software, but iOS yanked it shortly after the Zio company died. So it did run on both smartphone platforms, but you can't get it anymore for iOS. So it requires an Android device. I bought for this purpose an Amazon Kindle Fire so that I had something to receive the signal. So again, grc.com/Zio will take you to the page where I have links to the two eBay sales. One is the $40 pod, headband, and charger. The second one is the headbands only. And the headbands, Zio said you should replace them about every 90 days. But users with experience said that they lasted as long as a year. And I always wipe my forehead off with an alcohol wipe in order to get a better connection for my night's EEG reading. I also, at the lower down on that page, have a couple links so that you can see what EKG, or I'm sorry, keep saying EKG, EEG, what the Zio produces, which I've been recording. And I have to say, I am getting very near having a practical formula. It has already worked for a couple other people who've been following along and experimenting with what I call my alpha release of the HSF, the healthy sleep formula. So I think I'll have something to say about that before very much longer. But I did want to let anyone who's interested in monitoring their sleep at night for what I consider a bargain of $40. There's only like 90 of them there because they keep not, I don't know if they're going to raise their price or if they're going to relist them. They saw a large number of them sell a couple hundred after I tweeted on Sunday. I'm sure that this current auction will get wiped out quickly, but they do have more. So if you follow the links and it may say that it's been relisted, follow the relisting. I'll update the links as I as I find that they've been relisted. But I can say that I've been using it now for 10 weeks, about 70 nights, and I have a complete chronology of a breakdown showing the amount of time spent in REM, in light sleep, in deep sleep, and, you know, waking up in the middle and of the night and trying to go back to sleep. I also separately have a complete log of all the supplements that each night generated, and I'm beginning to see correlations now, you know, out of this massive data that I have collected. So, Zio Sleep Manager Pro. Oh, I should mention, too, that there is now a ZioBand.com company considering launching to replace, to create replacement bands. Neat. ZioBand.com. They're at this point, they're just gathering interest. So anyone who's interested should go there. People I can't think of the name. There's a neat hobbyist electronics company that manufactures all kinds of crazy widgets for makers. It'll come to me, and I have it on that page. They produce, or they offer for sale, silver impregnated cloth, exactly like what the Zio headband uses, and people have successfully repaired their headbands after the silvering of the cloth has worn off. That's what happens after some number of nights of use, is that the electrodes start losing conductivity because the silver just flakes off. So Spark Fun, that's the name I was trying to come up with. Spark Fun has three different links to three different grades and types of silver cloth. And if you Google Zio, Z-E-O, there's a huge culture of users. There's people have made third-party firmware. You can get other displayers and viewers of this information, all kinds of stuff. This thing was popular enough and successful enough that it created an ecosystem of its own that has continued to live on. I should mention that the one caveat, aside from the headband's infinite life, is that inside is a 3.7-volt LiPo cell, and these things cannot be user-opened. At some point, we will all be cracking ours open in order to replace the LiPo cell. It's the same one used by the little microcopters, the little micro quadcopters. So it's a very small but widely available 3.7-volt lithium polymer cell. Those, of course, have a limited life. So, and it's not just shelf life, that's limited, but it's also cycle life. So at some point, I expect that our Zio pods will start dying. I just want to give everyone a heads up. It's, you know, if I'm still into this and tracking my EEG sleep, I'm sure I will tackle cracking mine open and share the information about how to do that. But so will the ecosystem that exists. So anyway, grc.com/Zio, Z-E-O. That'll take you to my page where I've got links to the auctions and also links to show the graphs that I've been producing using mine. We were talking about sci-fi, and I was, and like on the question of what has happened, how was childhood's end so good? Why is The Expanse so good? And by the way, all morning, I tweeted this yesterday, all morning sci-fi has been doing a marathon of all previous episodes leading up to tonight's double episode season finale. And when I saw last week that it was the season finale, it's like, what? It's like, oh, crap. You know, now we have another thing like...
Game of Thrones.
like Game of Thrones, where the seasons are short, man. And you have to wait a year between them.
Well, you know, they put a lot of effort into brilliant. These, obviously. Yeah.
Anyway, so a number of people were happy to have that. But I wanted to answer the question, what has happened at sci-fi? And there was Wired have a podcast during which they recently interviewed Bill McGoldrick, who is the new head of programming at sci-fi. And Wired wrote that they said this past week, Sci-Fi premiered Childhood's End, a six-hour adaptation of Arthur C. Clarke's classic First Contact novel. The show is part of an ambitious new slate of book-to-TV adaptations being overseen by Bill McGoldrick, Sci-Fi's new head of original programming. And while Hollywood is known for misguided rewrites of sci-fi classics, McGoldrick was determined to create a faithful adaptation of Clarke's novel. McGoldrick said, quote, "We all just wanted to honor the book and really give him," meaning Arthur C. Clarke, "the recognition that he was just so prescient, because all the themes and all the things he was writing about are still so valid today." Then Wired writes, "For years, sci-fi has tried to broaden their appeal beyond science fiction fans, populating the channel with ghost hunters, pro wrestlers, and low-budget creature features like Sharknado and Mansquito. And while that did pull in new viewers, it also alienated sci-fi fans," and I'm adding, "and how." McGoldrick was brought in with a clear mandate: lure the fans back with smart, ambitious shows. Adapting classic books is part of that plan. McGoldrick said, "We want to honor that core fan base that is passionate about the material. We're really trying to focus on that core audience. And I think the way to do that is to respect the stuff that they really liked in the first place," which of course is music to my ears. And Wired says, "One thing fans are passionate about is space opera shows like Farscape, Firefly, and Battlestar Galactica. But in recent years, sci-fi simply lacked the budget to create those kinds of shows." McGoldrick said, "If you don't have the budget to go up into space and try to make that feel authentic, you might have to do some things that don't play to the core as much as sci-fi fans would like." And then Wired finishes saying, "But things have changed. The success of core genre shows like HBO's Game of Thrones and AMC's The Walking Dead have persuaded sci-fi's parent company, Comcast, to invest big in the channel. That means new sci-fi shows like Childhood's End and The Expanse are full of gorgeous visuals and jaw-dropping special effects. McGoldrick promises that future book adaptations, which include classic works, will have a similar focus on quality. McGoldrick says the wallet will open for the right show, and that's what makes it so exciting to have this job right now." And I, of course, say, yay. And again, The Expanse is turning out to be 100% worth watching. You know, and the ratings, IMDb, it's all up in the, you know, the high eights and nines out of 10 every single episode, and it deserves it. It had a little bit of a rough start, but I think it's found its footing. And so let's hope we have many more seasons of it. And only 10 episodes per. They've got a lot of, I mean, and believe me, I read the four books. This thing can go for, it can outlive the podcast. It there's even that chance.
Who wrote The Expanse?
I don't know. If you Google it, you'll find it instantly.
Yeah.
It's not an author that I recognize, and I've read nothing else he's done.
Yeah. All right. Interesting.
Did it come up?
I haven't Googled it yet.
As far as I know, that's all he's done.
I thought the chat room might.
Let
me Google it real quickly here. It is by James S. A. Corey. Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, and he does have a lot of other books.
That's actually two people, interestingly, Daniel Abraham and Ty Frank. And they did Leviathan Awakes, which I liked quite a bit. You recommended Leviathan Awakes, actually.
And that's the title of...
Oh.
The second of tonight's two episodes.
Okay, so that's one of the Expanse stories?
Yes.
Didn't realize that. Okay, now I'm putting two and two together. Yeah, because I read that on your recommendation. All right.
Yeah, and it's good science fiction. I absolutely enjoyed it. And for what it's worth, if people like the if watching the I guess we ought to find out if it's available on Audible. I didn't think to do that.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
If check, watching the series has whet your appetite.
That's how I listen to it, so I know it is, yeah.
Oh, okay, good. So available on Audible, then that's what you want to do for your Audible picks, because you could jump ahead. The books, you know, the books are always going to be better than
That's my problem with filmed or taped sci-fi, frankly.
Yeah.
You cannot spend enough money to do what you can do in your imagination. Ever.
Well, I mean, just, and I would argue that the medium doesn't provide the richness of description. You just, you know, you know, actors have to act what they're thinking, where right. the author can give you, precisely. I mean, detail what's going on in their head.
Yeah,
so
precisely.
Okay, now this is more. This is not a joke. It's real, but you'll get this, and because we've talked about this from time to time. I received an email today, the Temp Perfect mug update.
Oh, Lord.
Number 34.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was titled 2016, the Year of the Fire Monkey.
Oh, Lord.
And I got a kick out of it. It said, then the email is trying to make me feel special by saying for backers only. And I was thinking, you know, guys, at this point, you really don't get to limit your audience for, you know, or pick who gets to read this. And to give everyone a sense for this, first of all, I'll remind everyone, the Temp Perfect mug was a Kickstarter project that who even knows how long ago. It was one of the founding projects of Kickstarter.
It was a long time ago.
And with a very cool idea. The concept was that when you initially make a pot of coffee, it's too hot to drink. And so you have to wait for it to cool down. Then it passes through a range of drinkable temperature, after which time it becomes too cold to be very interested in being drunk. So these guys said, okay, we're going to
how you put that. The coffee is uninterested in being drunk at this point. I'm sorry. You may not drink me.
I'm no longer interesting to you.
No.
The idea was to not use a vacuum containment, or not only a vacuum containment, because the problem with that would be that it would successfully keep the coffee at the uncomfortably hot temperature for too long. So you first surround the coffee container with something with high thermal inertia, you know, like rock. Or copper, that copper, a huge copper, a thick copper sleeve would be wonderful. Because then, so their concept was you pour the super hot coffee into this thing, and the environment, the surrounding sleeve immediately takes up that excess heat, which was making the coffee too hot to drink, bringing it immediately down to drinkable temperature. Now you've heated up this collar around the coffee, and around it is a vacuum. So the heat cannot get out thanks to vacuum containment, but you've taken the heat away from the fluid into the solid, and that now holds your coffee at the temp perfect temperature 4 hours. And wouldn't it be nice if anyone actually had one of these?
Why is this so hard? By the way, you know that the reason this came up is that there is now a cup called Ember, which is actively maintaining the temperature. You set the temperature. It's got a heater and a cooler, I guess, some sort of heat pump system. And it's actively maintaining the temperature.
Right. You could do that with a Peltier cell to pump the heat. Yeah. Anyway, so to give you guys, to give everyone a sense for this, update number 34.
Oh, Lord.
January saw much progress on the Temp Perfect mug project.
Exciting.
Things are coming together.
Yes, indeed.
A number of sourcing sub-projects were conducted successfully. Loose ends were tied.
And all
mug parts and supplies from several factories were brought together in one place for the culmination of the Made in China phase of this project. The, quote, stuffing, unquote, of the shipping container arranged by our sourcing agency to bring everything to the U.S. Early in the month, we wrapped up the trials and final adjustments to the lid mold, which was the last tool to be finished, and all the lids for our Kickstarter rewards got made on time. All the plastic and rubber parts are now molded, inspected, consolidated, and ready to go into the container. These are the lids, gaskets, sleeves, feet, and shutter pivots that dress the stainless steel mug bodies. And the bodies? Most of the parts for those were made during my last trip to the factory in December. 45 bodies were assembled without trouble and finished and looked good before I left. Then, later in December, the factory had a problem.
Something went wrong?
That required a large number of those assemblies to be scrapped.
Oh, crap.
Parens, they were not strictly following the work instructions.
Oh,
the problem reported in last month's update, that would be update number 33. In January, the factory started to have other difficulties with the assembly. It seems because a machine was maladjusted. Not only the machine.
Okay, this is starting to sound like a work of fiction.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
After some time, they found a solution.
They did?
And were able to rework the parts and get back on track with production.
Oh, hallelujah.
Now, in the interest of our listeners, ears bleeding, I skipped a chunk and finished with, I just couldn't resist this one last paragraph. We do know we won't be getting the shipment out of China before Chinese New Year.
Well, these things happen.
Elvis has left the building. The workers, they actually wrote that, the workers are heading home to celebrate, and there's no one there to finish and pack and ship our mug parts. They'll be back February 19th. Stay tuned for update number 35.
It is possible that these are well-meaning, well-intentioned people who just...
Leo, I've not been sharing the updates. For 6 months, we went over through the battle of not liking the way the shutters were being
bent. They're perfectionists, these guys.
They are.
Yeah.
And I love them for that. Then there was the vacuum containment problem.
Well,
we had, not only in Zurich... with the Large Hadron Collider, has there been a vacuum containment problem?
Yes.
But with the TemPerfect mug as well, both using similar technology, three of the four.
Well, there you go.
Only
it's Large Hadron Collider technology. There you go. No wonder. It's amazing that it works at all.
And you and I remember you're down for one, and I am too. Yeah. Right?
How much did we spend on that? It was like
I think it was $189. I got the Darth Vader black one. I think fancy one, because I was absolutely convinced this thing was going to be the answer to my coffee prayers.
Well, it sounds like a great idea.
So we'll see.
I'm sure it is.
Speaking of answer to someone's prayers,
yes.
I won't drag everyone through a long testimonial. I'll just mention that Dennis Stevens publicly tweeted yesterday afternoon. And I saw this, and I thought, okay, I'll just mention this on the podcast. He said, Steve, I use for my job, at SGGRC, system I use for my job, work from home died. So that's a system he has at home. He works from home. He uses for his job. So work from home died. Ran my copy of SpinRite overnight. No errors reported. System booted fine. # happy. So to Dennis and everyone else who's having success with SpinRite, I thank you for your support and for letting me know and sharing your successes.
Let's take a break. We come back. We'll talk about three dumb routers. Three dumb routers. But first, let's talk about something smart. Getting the certs that will help you become an IT professional. Or if you already have the job, as many of you do, keeping your skills razor sharp. That's IT Pro TV's job. It's their mission. It's what they do so well and so entertainingly. And that's what I really like about IT Pro TV. They freely say, we took this idea from Leo because we were doing training and we saw Twit. We also saw your speech at NAB or my panel. And they said, we ought to do IT training kind of like Twit does it, but with a focus on getting the certs, you know, the A+ or the CCNA or the MCSA, the Certified Ethical Hacker Cert, AWS and virtualization and security and cryptography and desktop and server support and OS 10 and Windows and Linux. You know what? I could go on because they have now 1,000 hours of content, 50 new hours being added every week. If you go to itpro.tv/security now, you can see all of the stuff you can take. And you'll have the entire run of the place at your disposal with a very affordable monthly fee. They do have a basic plan that lets you watch the live production at any time. They do it like, I think, 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. And you can just learn. It's on demand or live. Yes, they have two studios now, so there's two choices at any given time. In fact, right now, what are they doing right now? I actually don't have the listing. I have to check. But you can watch live. You can download it. If you have a year subscription, you can buy a year at a time. You not only save 2 months, but you can actually download the files and watch on the airplane or whatever. With your low subscription fee, you get 100 step-by-step virtual machine labs. You get the Transcender practice exams. That's worth $109 by itself. They do have corporate and group pricing. Clients include some of the biggest universities in America, including Harvard, MIT, Stanford. I love this Certified Ethical Hacker course. This was Sean Philip Oriano's course, which I gobbled up. 28 hours and 24 minutes towards getting an actual certification in hacking and countermeasures. That's just fun by itself. I'm not going to get a cert, but that's just fun. That's just good stuff. Now, normally it's $57 a month. $570 if you subscribe for a year, 2 free months. But we've got a great deal for you. First of all, go there, try it free for a week, and get 30% off your subscription when you use the offer code SN30. Now, that's going to take it down to about $40 a month, $400 for a whole year. That is really a good deal. $400 for a whole year. And, of course, they know that, you know, this is goal-oriented learning. Once you get that cert, you can cancel at any time. It's very easy because they're geeks, and they hate it when, you know, people trap you into a subscription. Let's see what's going on. Okay, Studio 2, they're doing Microsoft Excel 2016. What fun is that, huh? They even have a chat room like we do, so you can ask questions of the hosts. They do study groups. It's already February. I know you wanted to get a great job in 2016. Go now. Hie thee hither to itpro.tv/security now. Get that discount. Get the trial. Use the offer code SN30. Do as Rodolfo did. You know, he heard about it on Security Now. He signed up. Within a few months, he had the skills and the cert. You kind of need both, right? And got a new job as a sysadmin at a better company for double the pay. Way to go, Rodolfo! Lots of success stories on the site. And lots of success stories with our audience, because we know a lot of you have been taking advantage of this. Do it. itpro.tv/security now. 30% off. Not for just the first month of the year, but for the life of your account. With the offer code SN30. Steve, I still have one more commercial to do, so we're going to take a break in the middle of your thrust.
Perfect. Perfect. I was going to remind you to do that, as a matter of fact. So I'm glad you did.
Yep.
And I wanted to mention that 76 Zio pod systems have
already
sold in the last hour.
Just now?
Yes.
You're a monster.
So
they should never have gone out of business.
What happened was that they were unable to compete
right.
with the actigraph. They'd like, oh, wait, you mean it'll count my steps and tell and remind me that I'm not standing enough and that I need to walk more and what my heart rate is and also monitor my sleep? Oh, well, then what do I need this Zio thing
right.
for?
Exactly.
Except, of course, none of them can tell you what's actually going on in your head unless they're, you know, measuring the electrical activity in your head. So nobody who might think this will be cool will be disappointed. With the caveats that the headband wears out, the battery will need replacement at some point.
And it's not good for television personalities because you come into work with four dots on your forehead.
And I wanted to ask you, because you mentioned the three divots, you know, that doesn't last more than 10 minutes, does it?
Yes.
Oh.
It lasted all morning. In fact, I went in.
Maybe you had it too tight.
Yeah, it could be. I don't want to know how badly I'm sleeping. I'm sleeping terribly. I know that.
Actually, Leo, I'm about to have a solution.
Okay, I'm gonna wait for the solution. I'm gonna let you do the guinea pigging.
Yeah,
he's the guinea pig. Yep,
I'm happy.
Keep guinea pigging.
happy being a guinea pig. Anyway, so this is we'll call this a benefit to the listeners who listen to the podcast live. They were definitely able to get the Zio pods if they wanted them. I know I've already had conversation with a seller this morning because they wrote to say, what happened? And I said, I told you I was going to tweet about this, and now I'm going to do a podcast about it. And so, you know, you ain't seen nothing yet. So if the links don't work, if it's sold out, then I'll update the link, so be patient, and I'll have an update, a brief update, I promise. I'll make it brief next week about to remind people if there are any still left in their big box. They said they had hundreds, and they've only sold at most a couple hundred because I've been keeping an eye on it. So they probably have lots left, I hope. Okay. The question is, what we're going to answer, what I'm going to explain this for the balance of this podcast is why no fewer than three dumb routers can create true network isolation. I'll explain why I was wrong last week, why I chose that last week, why what I have on the web page that's 10 years old, it was dated August of 2006, why I did it that way then and why that was wrong, because, okay, so, well, and exactly what the problem is. Why is it that this is the only solution? So the goal is to create robustly, knowably isolated networks. There's no question, none, that we're going to be seeing Internet of Things security disasters. Anyone who's been listening to this podcast couldn't believe for a minute that that's not going to happen. We're seeing them weekly with mature operating systems from companies whose entire technical focus is on, like, you know, is on not having problems, instead of some, you know, Chinese light bulb manufacturer that wants to sell light bulbs and for whom security, absolutely couldn't care less. So the danger will be that there will be devices which phone home or which map a port using universal plug and play, or as we call it here, universal plug and pray, through your router to allow some web management system to access the device. Then Shodan, the search engine for the Internet of Things, will scan the port space of the internet and will find that light bulb with no, where security was an afterthought. And that will mean that the instant that a problem is found, you know, it will have to have buffer overruns. There will have to be, you know, exposed telnet ports. I mean, all the kinds of things that like even supposedly secure routers have. You know, you have to know that other things that are wanting to be on the internet just for the sake of being on are going to have problems. And they will be exposed to the net. The problem then is that bad guys, the moment a vulnerability is found, can use Shodan to find the 50,000 of those which are currently plugged in random people's homes the world over, and use that to create a beachhead, to get into the device and essentially create a connection in back through the router into the user's LAN. And once there, they can do whatever they want to. They are essentially, a bad guy has gotten onto a device on your network, and we know what that means. Not good. So it is imperative that, I mean, truly, it is imperative that this class of what we know are going to be sketchy security yet connected to the global network devices not be connected to your internal LAN. So for the first time, there's a big need for network isolation. In the fullness of time, I expect that router manufacturers will address this. That, you know, we have this notion of a guest network. Although we talked about last week how, at least in the case of one Netgear router that one of our listeners wrote in about, when the secondary network is put in isolation mode to isolate it from the primary network, then the individual devices on that guest network cannot see each other. And it's also a huge question, what is the nature of this isolation? And I'll explain when we get into talking about IP to MAC address mapping and ARP, the address resolution protocol, which is what we're about to do, why that idea worries me. It's one thing to isolate at the IP level, but it is entirely possible that these things would not be isolated at the Ethernet level, and it is completely possible to operate at the Ethernet level, not the IP level. So the question is, how good will the isolation be in the future when we really get it? And is it too much isolation? Because there are instances where we want the various Internet of Things devices to see each other. You know, Nest has now a growing family of devices that are all on the same network and may need to be talking to each other. So having them physically isolated on each, essentially on their own little guest spoke of the network, that may not work either. So we want absolute bulletproof isolation, which is independent of how any router functions, so that it's brain dead. I mean, just brain dead simple. So that's why I titled the podcast Three Dumb Routers, because it turns out that if you have three dumb routers, three absolutely feature stripped, they don't have to, you know how to do anything except be a router, then you can achieve absolute security. The reason I have been reluctant until now to promote this is just because it seems like a lot to go through. Three routers, that's two more than one router. And, you know, one router is what most people have. And two routers gave you more security. But I'll explain why it's not enough security. So you can have one router with no security, or, you know, cross your fingers, two routers with better security, but it does take three to have absolute security. And the reason I do like this solution is over the course of the last 10 years, routers have dropped in cost so that you can get them for 15, 20, 25, 30 bucks. The main router doesn't even have to be Wi-Fi. There will be I should explain, this is in a Y connection as opposed to a series connection, so that you have two primary routers, a secure router and we'll call an insecure router, and they both have their WAN ports connected to the sort of the root or the hub router, which connects to the internet. So they're connected to its LAN ports. And you could put other stuff on that first router, but it's better not to. It's better to keep everything behind these routers. And if you needed a third completely isolated network, then you could go to a 4 router or a 5 router. That is, the idea being that you have that networks to be isolated have to be behind their own router, and those routers, however many you have, two or more, then need to share the primary, sort of the we'll call it the root router. Why all of this? The problem is that it is possible for something malicious that gets on your network to either use IP protocol or one of the Ethernet protocols in order to obtain access to your network traffic, which you absolutely don't want. Let's first discuss the scenario that I described last week, which is the reverse of what I proposed 10 years ago. Last week, I said that the IoT devices should be on the inside router. We just had two routers daisy chained that is linked in series, and frankly, I'm not sure why I said that last week. I thought, okay, what was I thinking? Because it's difficult to come up with a justification for that configuration compared to what I had 10 years ago, which makes more sense. The problem with last week is that I know what I was thinking, and that was that the external network, the middle network, the one between the two routers, would have a different network address than the one behind the secondary router. So anything that was anything malicious that was scanning its own network behind the second router, which is what I proposed last week, it would only see all of its other IoT devices. However, a number of people pointed out that the weakness with this is that if one of those malicious devices behind the second router did a trace route out to the public internet, the first hop of the trace route returns its own gateway IP. That is, it's the IP of its router where it sends packets that are bound for the internet. The second hop of a trace route would be the external router's gateway IP. In other words, the second hop of a traceroute would reveal to something malicious on the innermost router the intermediate network's network numbering, and it could then scan that network. If it sent IP packets out to the Class C network, the 254 IPs in that network, the router, the gateway IP would tell it it would allow it to infer the network numbering of the exterior network, and then probes sent out to those IPs would get routed to devices on the intermediate network, which is bad. We don't want that. So the problem is if the secure network, I'm sorry, if the potentially malicious network is inside router, it can, and it, you know, again, we can't depend upon security by obscurity, so we have to assume that the malicious network is as smart as it needs to be, or a malicious device on the IoT network is as smart as it can be. A simple trace route, that is to say, setting your packet with a TTL of 2, a time to live of 2, the first router, its own router, decrements that packet's TTL to 1 and forwards it to the first router. It decrements that TTL packet to 0, the TTL in the packet to 0, and sends back an ICMP message saying that this packet is expired. The ICMP message contains the IP of the interface that bounced the packet back. That will be the gateway IP that allows something malicious on the inside network to determine the exterior network's numbering, and then it can simply use standard IP probes to scan the network in the middle that I was saying was secure, and that's bad. Okay, that's how that breaks. Now let's reverse it. 10 years ago, when I created the NAT security chaining idea, I said we're going to put the super secure stuff on the interior router. Still just 2, and they're daisy chained. Super secure stuff on the interior router. The idea being that the router functioning like a NAT prevents unsolicited packets from coming in, only allowing them to go out. And so only solicited things come back in. So that's very much like the routers we all have now. We have routers on the internet. Lord knows the public internet is a hostile environment. So our routers are right now protecting us. Our single routers are protecting us from the hostility on the internet from getting into our lands. And we know that works. So that was the model I had proposed 10 years ago. But there's a difference between the internet and a LAN, because what this would mean would be, in this configuration, the Internet of Things devices, the potentially malicious devices, would be sitting on the network in between the two routers. That always made me uncomfortable, because that meant that the traffic from our secure, what we want to be our own, super secure private LAN, that traffic is passing through the environment, the network, where a potentially malicious device could reside. Well, what could that device do? The device can scan that local network and might even find that there's, might even be able to determine that there's a router there. But it can't get in any more than somebody out on the internet can get in to the routers that we have right now protecting us from the internet. But devices on a LAN have an additional power that things out on the internet don't have. And that's that they're on the same Ethernet network. So let's step back for a second and remember a little bit of the dynamics of how Ethernet works. We have covered this in complete detail in past podcasts. If anyone's interested, go look for ARP Resolution Protocol, ARP, ARP Resolution Protocol. We did a podcast that explained it once. But for now, I'll sort of summarize that. The idea is that nothing about Ethernet. Ethernet was a networking technology that was developed at PARC, the Palo Alto is Xerox PARC, Xerox's Palo Alto Research Center, by Bob Metcalf. And it was used to connect systems together completely separate from the internet. It doesn't use packet routing. It doesn't use IP addresses. There are no IP addresses on Ethernet. That was all grafted on later. Ethernet uses MAC addresses, Media Access Control, MAC addresses. And our network savvy friends have probably seen them. They are expressed as six pairs of hex digits, typically with colons separating them. So it'll be like 00 colon FE colon 02 colon and so forth. Six pairs of hex digits. That represents, since each pair of hex is 8 bits, that means that 3 of those is 24 bits and 6 of those is 48 bits. The MAC address is a 48-bit ID. And by convention, the first 3 are a manufacturer ID, and the second 3 pair is a serial number. So the idea was, in the original concept for Ethernet, every single Ethernet NIC, as they were called, network interface card, it would have a globally unique address. Nowhere would 2 different NICs, Ethernet adapters, have the same address. And this was very clever, especially back then. This was a long time ago. This was in the 80s. The idea being that if every single thing that could ever be hooked up had a unique address, then you didn't have to worry about them having the same address. You didn't have to have jumpers to like set the address. Everyone remembers, you know, IRQ disasters and COM port jumpers and all of the mess that happened when you didn't have a guarantee of uniqueness. Well, Ethernet solved that from the beginning. The idea was if every manufacturer had their own high 24-bit number, and that manufacturer never made 2 adapters with the same lower 24-bit number, you could, by definition, never have 2 that had the same 48-bit number. And that's the way Ethernet is. But none of that had anything to do with the Internet protocol, which came afterwards. So now we have a problem of we've got Ethernet, and we love the way that works. things are wired together, Ethernet works. Who was the company, Leo, the early networking company with 3com? An N?
With an N? Novell.
There was Novell. There, that's it. Yeah, 3com and Novell. Novell was really big in the early days. And remember, these network interface cards used to be full size. They cost a couple $1,000, $1,000 each just for one of these things. And I remember at GRC back in mid-1980, we had a big, the office was sort of two suites put side by side. And our Ethernet backbone was a single U that, because it was a coax cable that was terminated at each end.
It was serial. So if anybody unplugged their computer, the whole network went down.
Right. Well,
it's like Christmas lights.
That was one way to do it. The other was you had taps.
Right.
So you had the
you'd have
this
a ring.
Exactly. It was called 10 base 2. Right. Or wait, no, 10 base
T. 10 base T.
T was twisted pair.
Twisted pair.
10 base 2. I can't. I think it was 10 base 2 and then 100 base 2 was when we went. So it used to even be 10 megabits, which back then was blazing speed.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, the point was that it worked. Now along comes IP, and we want to give machines, computers, and routers. We want to electrically connect them with the Ethernet, which we already have, and it works. But we need to give them not these wacky MAC addresses, but IPs, because by the other thing about the MAC address, it is not routable. The whole Ethernet technology is a non-routable technology. It is by definition point to point. Everything is on the same big network, and because everything has a unique IP, you just say, hey, you just send something to that. I mean, sorry, not a unique IP, a unique MAC address. You just send something to that MAC address, and it gets it. I mean, because what happens is everything is listening all the time. All Ethernet devices listen to everything going on. So they're sucking in all of the traffic because they're all connected to the same big single backbone, tapped off of it. So they're listening to all the chatter going on. And as every packet is received, they check to see whether the destination for the packet is their MAC address. And if so, it's for them. And so then they process the packet. If not, they discard it. But, and this is key, they do receive it. Okay, so we want to add a routable protocol. That was the brilliance of the IP protocol, was this notion that we would take 32-bit addressing and we would partition at an arbitrary place. We would cut that 32 bits so that the uppermost chunk of bits was a network number, and the balance of the 32 was a device on that network. And so what makes this routable is that this forms a hierarchy of networks that allows routers all over the world to look at the destination IP and figure out where to send it to get it closer to its destination using routing tables, which are able to be efficient due to the same hierarchy. Okay, so we need to add a routable numbering system to a network, Ethernet, that doesn't have any. It's just MAC addresses, point to point. No, there was never a concept of routing back then. So what was created was an additional protocol called ARP, Address Resolution Protocol. Like its name sounds, it is used to resolve addresses. The way it works is as follows. every device that is on the Ethernet, and there's like one Ethernet, gets an IP address. And that's manually assigned. That's why, for example, DHCP assigns an IP address to our computer when we ask the router for one. We just say, yeah, I don't care what my IP is, just give me one. And so the router hands it out. Or we manually configure an IP address. Typically, you don't manually configure a MAC address. You can more recently override the default MAC address that NICs have, but typically you don't need to because they're still going to be globally unique. So the individual endpoints are assigned a kind of arbitrary IPs. They have to be on the same routable network so that they can talk to each other and so that things outside that network know how to get in and so that those devices know to send things to the gateway IP if they're bound for outside the network. So you still need to obey IP routing rules, but the particular IP any given device with an Ethernet adapter receives doesn't matter. So one of the things that is configured for any IP device is the IP address of its gateway. That by definition, the gateway is the IP to which will be sent any packets bound outside the network. And so I'm sure anyone who's looked at their IP configuration has seen, oh, look, there's in my gateway IP. And it's, you know, on 192.168 networks, it's typically 192.168.0. sometimes .0.1, more commonly .0.255 or 254. It's up at the end of the block of IPs, or sometimes .100. It doesn't really matter. Again, as I said, IP numbering is arbitrary as long as it is consistent over the use of that device on the network. So when a computer turns on and comes up on an Ethernet network, in the background, part of the booting up process is the kernel driver knows that it's been assigned a certain IP and that it's been told the gateway has a certain IP. So it needs to know the MAC address of the gateway. That's the key. Remember that it's hooked to Ethernet, and Ethernet uses MAC addressing to send packets around, not IP addressing. IP is sort of an associated layer on top, but the actual packets are sent to MAC addresses, not to IP addresses. So in order for this computer to connect to the outside world, it has to know the MAC address of the gateway. So what it does is it sends out what's known as an ARP broadcast that the Ethernet protocol, just like the IP protocol, has a concept of a broadcast address. It's an address to which something can be sent that everybody will receive. And the ARP broadcast uses the ARP protocol in the Ethernet packet header some bits for protocol number. And so it very much like with IP, where we had the TCP protocol, UDP, ICMP, and so on, Ethernet had bits reserved for different protocols, and ARP is one of them. So that's what makes a packet an ARP packet, is it's got the protocol bits set to ARP. And this particular one is a broadcast that says, to everybody who has this IP. And so it uses the address resolution protocol specifically created for the IP protocol to say, hey, listen, everybody, do you have this IP? And everybody receives it. And the, if, for example, you're asking for the IP of the gateway, you're asking for 192.168.0.255, for example. And so you say, who has that IP? Well, the router receives that ARP broadcast, which is an Ethernet broadcast, and looks and it says, oh, that's me. And so it responds to that device saying, I am the MAC address that is responsible for this IP. Now the computer that we've just turned on knows how to send its IP packets over the Ethernet network. It knows if it wants to send it to the gateway that they need to be addressed to that MAC address. So ARP creates this mapping. The problem is that there's no other security protocol in place. That is, this assumes everybody on the network can be trusted. And in our deliberately adversarial, malicious IoT device model, that's absolutely what we don't have. We need to tolerate a malicious device on whatever network it's on. And where we left off with this was good stuff goes on the inside, IoT stuff goes in the middle. And after we hear from Leo, I'm going to explain why that breaks.
We got caught in an ARP hole, but we're back. And now we get to the valves. That's next. You know, actually, valve is a good description. Isn't that what they used to call, what the Brits used to call radio tubes or valves?
Yes,
and transistors
because they
are valves, right?
They're electron valves.
Yeah, one way tickets. Our show today brought to you by FreshBooks, the super simple cloud accounting software. If you're a freelancer or a small business, you will love, because I could tell you one thing I, as a freelancer, did not love. Rummaging through receipts to keep track of expenses, then collating them all in the spreadsheet, then importing them into a invoice. Oh, wait a minute. Now I got to open Word and make the invoice and then format it all and then add the bill. Oh, when it's I'm billing Canada. Oh, I got to do it in Canadian dollars and then send the invoice. And then, of course, the worst part, tracking down the customers who neglect to pay you. Not probably because of they're malicious, but because, like you, they put it off. That's the situation I was in 2004 when I was used to bill Rogers. And Amber MacArthur told me, I was, of course, complaining about it. She says, don't, just go to FreshBooks. They're friends of mine. They just got started. They're in Toronto. FreshBooks, now 10 years later, and I think something like 5 million customers later, they are still the way, if you are a freelancer, to invoice, to get paid faster, to create beautiful professional looking invoices. And they've added so many great features. I just love this. They have the deposit. You could request a deposit now from. See, so what I would do is I would pay for the hotel, pay for the flight, be out of pocket. And then, of course, if I forget to invoice, be out of pocket for months. Now you can request a deposit in FreshBooks. You don't have to cover the costs out of pocket or wait until the end of a project to get paid. FreshBooks asks as an escrow for you and your client. They just announced a new card reader. If you're the kind of person who does work in people's homes, you go to somebody's house, and you know you present them with an estimate. You can use the FreshBooks app to do it right on the phone, on the iPhone. It's amazing. Then you do the work. Then you say, "Here, look at my iPhone. There's the bill." And then this is the best part. And by the way, this is the whole secret to FreshBooks. You put their EMV chip card reader. They can swipe the stripe, dip the chip, pay you right there. See, It making payment easy for your client solves a multitude of problems. Same thing with the email invoices. They could press a button and use online pay services, a whole raft of them, and pay you. And it turns out FreshBooks users get paid on an average of 5 days faster, and it's just because of that, I think. You could track billable hours in the app, right? And then they go right into the invoice. You could take pictures of receipts. No more shoeboxes. They go right into the invoice. It is a great, great service. And yes, they not only handle dollars, Canadian and U.S., they handle hundreds. Well, I don't know how many there are. Dozens of currencies. They handle them all automatically. So, I mean, this... Look, it's such a great solution. Go to freshbooks.com/security now, and you can try it free for 30 days, and you will see, and you will never go back. It was the greatest thing ever. I love FreshBooks. You will, too. freshbooks.com/security now. Use security now. Well, actually, it's not an offer code, but they, I think at some point they say, how did you hear about this? And you say, well, security now, because we want to make sure that Steve gets credit. freshbooks.com/security now. Start your 30-day free trial right now. You do not have to take my word for it, but I would say, trust me, I've used it. I used it for years, and I love it. FreshBooks.com/security now. All right, Steve. Three dumb routers, part two.
Okay, so we have the address resolution protocol, which is used to allow Ethernet devices, which are... on the same Ethernet network, because remember, Ethernet is non-routable, to allow them to navigate and negotiate routable IP addresses. Oh, and by the way, I was going to mention, you can now understand how it is that you can have multiple IPs on the same device. For, you know, it's often called or called multi-homed. The idea being that a single Ethernet adapter could be assigned multiple IPs. There, you know, at first people think, wait a minute, how is that possible? Well, now we know that. Remember that the ARP broadcast says who has this IP, and so if the OS behind a single Mac adapter, you know, NIC, if it has been configured with three, for example, Internet Protocol addresses, IP addresses, it says, I do. I'm the one who gets packets that you want to send to that IP. So that's how you can have a many-to-one mapping of IP addresses to Ethernet adapters. The problem is there is no security in this system. And this was all designed back in an era when we assumed everybody was going to be a good actor on the Ethernet. So there are terms like ARP spoofing that have been used, and maybe, you know, people may have heard about if they don't know the details. Well, here's the details. We have to assume that a malicious device is sitting like a light bulb, is always on, listening to the network, knowing what's going on. The mapping, this ARP technology has a timeout, and there's additional complications I won't get into, but it means that from time to time, devices will be needing to refresh their mapping. That is one of the ways that it allows a devices to change their IP address and eventually be recognized by equipment at a new location within the same network. So this is not something you only do once. The reason I mention this is that if you screw in a malicious light bulb at some point in the future so that it's late to the conversation, it's still going to be able to monitor all of the internet traffic. And if it sees, or I should say when it sees, a broadcast asking who has the gateway IP, and of course, it knows the gateway IP. Sorry?
this. I do. Yeah. I know it.
It can respond with its own MAC address before the router does. And the,
so clever.
Yes.
So it can infect the whole network.
Exactly. It's a malicious device sitting on an Ethernet will hear the who has from every device on the network. And if it's been designed to be quick or just is quicker, it's able to get its response back to the querying device first. And that device will think it's the gateway, which means that all of the traffic goes to it rather than to the gateway. But even without that, in a shared environment, if, for example, some of these devices are wired, if they're not behind a switch, then it's just like the old days where everything is on the same physical wire and all the packets are on the wire. So there are active and passive ways that something malicious on an Ethernet network can, in the worst case, monitor what's going on, but very likely create its own man-in-the-middle position. If it responds to, if it were to respond to the interior router before the exterior router can, the interior router will send everything bound for the internet to the light bulb's MAC address. And that then becomes a man-in-the-middle able to filter all of the traffic. And it would then forward it to what it knows is the real MAC address so that it would also remain invisible. All the traffic would be going through it, nothing on the interior network, which believes it is super secure, would know. So that's why super secure inside with malicious network in like able to see that, able to see and receive the traffic in the middle doesn't work. And of course, we first covered why the reverse doesn't work, because the something malicious on the inside router can figure out the exterior network. Now, routers block Ethernet. Routers are IP routers. They are not Ethernet routers. So, for example, ARP doesn't make any sense for ARP packets, the address resolution protocol, to go through a router. They don't. They are always constrained to a single LAN. So what that makes is that these dumb routers are just smart enough to route IP, but not to route Ethernet, because Ethernet is by default a non-routable protocol. So they block absolutely all, because it makes no sense, block the address resolution protocol. So now what we have is we want security. And as I said at the beginning of this, I've now demonstrated, the problems with any two router configuration is that either the router on the malicious router on the inside could gain IP access to the IP network on the outside, that is in between the two routers, and that's not good. It can't get Ethernet access, and it can't use ARP, but it doesn't need to. It can use IP packets and use the routers to route the data into the network that you wish was more secure. If we switch things around, now the malicious device can use the Ethernet, because it's on the same Ethernet as the link between the routers, and it can use Ethernet protocols like ARP in order to get up to mischief. So neither of those work. The only secure solution, and the beauty of this is it is utterly bulletproof, is we put each of the networks behind their own router. That constrains them to their own LAN, there, and the routers block Ethernet and block ARP and any way for them to get out. So, each of those networks behind their own router is able to send data out. Now, in the worst case, let's say now that one of them is malicious. It could do what I first proposed, is it could do a trace route. If it did a trace route, it would see its own router, then it would see the shared router, which is the Y-ing router, where these separate routers, WANs, are plugged into the LAN connections of this root router. It could determine that router's gateway IP. That could tell it that intermediate network's IP numbering, but nothing is on that intermediate network, this Y network, except other routers' WAN connections, and we know those are safe because those are what right now protect us in a single router configuration from the internet. Of course, safe, assuming that those routers don't have security problems or other problems. But this gives us what we want. It means that essentially by having a single root router with then spokes off to additional routers, each of those networks, and it doesn't matter now which one is secure, which one it's not, you could have three, you could have four, you could have as many as you want, all concentrating down to a single shared root router that goes out to the internet. And each of the interior routers completely isolates its network from all the others. That's secure. I've been shying away from going this far because three routers is a bigger pain than two routers, which is a bigger pain than one router. But the beauty is they're cheap now. Probably you've got some in the closet, so it may not be a problem. That root router could be a non-Wi-Fi router. In fact, it probably does not want to be Wi-Fi unless maybe you used it for a guest network. But it's really better if it has no devices on it at all except other routers. Those are where you would want to have your Wi-Fi for your truly secure network and your probably not so secure Internet of Things network. Many of them are going to be hooked up with Wi-Fi, like the various Nest devices and so forth, you know, and the infamous light bulb that is trying to break into our network. That's the only way I can see it being secure. The beauty is this doesn't require any configuration, anything fancy, any settings of any kind. It's just it uses the basic NAT concept that all routers share. It blocks Ethernet, it routes IP, and it fully isolates the networks that are behind each of these routers so that they cannot see each other. And I don't think there is any I don't think there's a simpler way to do this. Yes, if you have a fancy router, if you've got a firewall, if you're using pfSense, you know, if you really know what you're doing, you could pull this off with a single device. But for, I think, 99.9% of us, if we're going to start playing with Internet of Things devices, give that its own router, take your main router, and have them both feed into a router that goes out to the internet, then you've got isolation and you don't have to worry about any of their settings.
Are you going to update your page to reflect this new setup? Because I think I need a map.
Yeah. I don't want to.
No, I guess not.
I got to work on Squirrel.
Let's see. How do we? I mean, I have the show notes. I guess that's the best way to do it, right? Is to have people.
Yeah, the show notes don't. The show
they
notes
don't have a
don't
diagram.
Really show anything. Actually, the current page. There is a link. There is a link on that page. The router configuration, where I go into much more detail. If you and so so there's two pages there. There's the main page linked off of the GRC website menu, and several times I refer to another page. If you read those, you will not have any problem setting up a Y configuration.
All right.
You'll have everything you need.
Yeah, because I think I need to do that. And you're right. I have routers all over the place.
Yeah, we have all got. Yeah. We have all of the old ones that we're no longer using. This is the way to do it. Simple. At the expense of a few more routers, it creates absolute network isolation.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody in the chat room said, "Leo, here's your map. The letter Y." Yeah, that's true.
And I think you'll find it just works. You just plug them together. It's like, works.
Yeah.
And that's what people
Amazing.
Are going to experience. It just works. And the beauty is it is absolutely secure.
So none of them in bridging mode. Each of them doing their own NAT. That's
right.
The key. And the bottom of the Y is coming to the public, is out to the outside world.
Exactly.
The center part is, of course, your main
root router,
and then you have your two subsidiary routers, one of which is an IoT router.
Yep, yeah. And doesn't matter which is which.
Right.
And you could have three if you wanted to have three isolated networks. What this does is each router creates
a menorah, if you want
a domain under menorah. Yes,
have a menorah. The whole idea is that there's that root router, and then they're all subsidiary off of that, and none of them talk to each other. Each of them, it's basically a handmade VLAN, is what it is. If your root router could do VLANs, that's exactly what it would look like.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But and segmenting is not enough. It needs to be a VLAN.
And a VLAN you need to be careful with, because you're using VLAN tags to differentiate networks.
Right.
But unless you have a switch which is also isolating networks based on VLAN tags, then you still have a situation where something on the Ethernet can see all the packets.
Where this falls down, of course, is if you're on one leg of the Y and you somehow need to talk to the IoT device.
Correct.
Because it's isolated. You can't. And that's the whole point. It can't talk to you and it can't hijack you.
Correct.
But some IoT devices, of course... But you could just join that network.
Yes.
It looks like another network.
Exactly. Yeah. The idea would be your iPhone, for example, has that Wi-Fi network in its list.
Right.
And so if you need to talk to that device, you just switch over to that wireless network.
You name that WAN, caution, insecure IoT network.
Don't stay here.
Don't live in this.
Visit briefly.
And you want to make sure, and unfortunately, way too many devices do this, that you don't have devices that will automatically, hunt between different access points, because that you don't want it to actually get in there. You'd have to forget it manually.
Well, as long as it did not know as it didn't know your Wi-Fi
password. You have to forget it. But it does. The minute you use it, it does. Now you have to forget it after using it. So caution, insecure IoT network, do not use it. And make sure you forget it after you use it. Otherwise, it will automatically log into it next time.
I see. Right, right, right. Yes, yes.
It's a long SSID. I don't know what the limit is. Good stuff. Again, what is it's grc.com/...
I don't have an IP for that.
Okay.
I mean,
I
don't have a simple URL.
Okay.
It's research... Then the first
under the
research
menu,
research general NAT router security.
Okay, that's easy to find.
That's easy to find.
The thing is, that's so great about GRC is it's Steve's Minecraft server. He's been digging holes there, building edifices there for years, and there's so much stuff there, and it's really fun just to browse around. Now, of course, I got to remind you that the main thing, the thing that pays the bills for everything else, is the great SpinRite, world's best hard drive maintenance and recovery utility. That's it. That's the only thing you have to pay for there. Everything else is free, including security now. He has audio versions and transcripts, written transcripts of each and every show there, plus the show notes. You're going to want to read these show notes, I think. That's at grc.com. Now, we also have copies of the show, audio and video, for no apparent reason, at our site, twit.tv/... Well, people like to look at you. at twit.tv/SN. That's the URL for that. But it's also, you know what? You can subscribe to this show, one of the oldest podcasts in the world. 10 years we've been doing this. It's on every podcatcher there is. And if it's not, shame on them. I mean, it. And there's 5 Apple TV apps, and it's on every one of those. And there's a Roku app, and there's like an infinite number of apps on iOS and Android and Windows Phone. Get a Twit app or get a podcast app if you don't want to get a Twit app and subscribe, because you do not want to miss this show. In fact, what you want to do is burn DVDs of this show and put it on the shelf, because it's an education.
Don't we wish we had tapes of all of the old Call for Now and Screensavers episodes? And so
I do. I mean, somebody does, I guess, but that would be great. You know, they found Super Bowl I.
Someday this will be the same. It'll be the same way. You know, I don't know. You and I will still be around, but still.
I've got the archive. They found Super Bowl I, and the NFL doesn't want it, but they won't let the guy sell it. It's like, come on.
Wow.
Anyway, thank you, Steve. We will see you
My friend,
next time.
Pleasure. We'll do a Q&A next week. And we're down to only 4 Zio pods left in the auction, down from 100. So our live listeners got the benefit.
Wow.
And I'm sure that they will restock. And there should be more available for those who are picking up the podcast on their devices.
Wow. I bought like 4 of the refills, so I figured that'd get me through a year anyway.
Good. And I'll have a healthy sleep formula soon.
I need the healthy sleep formula.
Many people do.
Thank you, Steve. We'll see you next Tuesday, 1:30 Pacific, 4:30 Eastern, 21:30 UTC for Security Now.
Bye.
Security Now.